That's right.
Okay, well, I see Shane is arriving, which means we can start. So welcome, everybody. Thanks so much for coming. My name is Peter Midgley. I'm the director of the Copyright Licensing Office here on campus. And we're so excited to welcome you all to our CopyChat training. Hopefully you're in the right place. This is Copyright Essentials for Content Creators and Communicators. As I said, my name is Peter Midgley. I'm going to let Cami introduce herself quickly. Maybe?
Now I have to unmute.
Okay. I'm Cami Stevenson. I oversee licensing for continuing education here on campus.
Why don't you go ahead, Cami?
Okay, and we'll just jump in. We're going to start with a really brief copyright primer. This is not a copyright basics presentation, so we're going to go through this very quickly, but for any of you who are not familiar with copyright law, this should hopefully give you just a little bit of an orientation. So, maybe? Mm-hmm. Thanks, Peter. Okay, so very quickly, we're going to go over how to obtain copyright protection. So prior to 1978, anytime someone created a work, they had to both register their copyright with the Copyright Office in Washington, D.C., and place one of those copyright notices that we're all very familiar with in order to have a valid copyright. However, after 1978, once you've created something that has a minimum level of creativity and you fix that work in a medium, so it's accessible to other people after you've created it, you hold a valid copyright in that work. There's no need to register in order to have a valid copyright now. Categories of copyright. Copyright is only applicable to certain specific categories of works. Those include literary works, musical works, including any accompanying lyrics, dramatic works, including any music, so operas and musicals, those kinds of things, pantomimes and choreographic works, so dances are potentially subject to copyright protection, pictures, sculptures, graphics, those types of things that are pretty common knowledge when you think of copyright, movies, motion pictures and other audiovisual works, sound recordings are subject to copyright protection, and architectural works are subject to copyright protection. And as the holder of a copyright, you have 6 exclusive rights that only you can exercise as it relates to your work, or you can authorize others to exercise these rights on your behalf. So as a copyright holder, you have the exclusive right to reproduce your work, to make copies, to prepare adaptations or derivative works. So if you've written a book, if you're J.K. Rowling, you have the exclusive right to turn that book into a movie or a play or a video game, to create adaptations of your work. You have the exclusive right to distribute your work. You have the exclusive right to publicly perform your work, as well as publicly display your work. And in the case of sound recordings, copyright holders have the right, the exclusive right for public performance by digital audio transmission. And what that means is sound recordings played over things like Spotify or Pandora, iHeartRadio, those types of platforms. And our office has come up with this helpful mnemonic device to help you remember the 6 exclusive rights of a copyright holder. If you can just remember RAP DDD, those are the exclusive rights of a copyright holder: reproduction, adaptation, public performance, distribution, displaying publicly, and digital audio transmissions of sound recordings.
So congratulations, you're all now copyright experts. and now we're going to move into some tools that our office has developed that we're rolling out here today. The first is our online decision trail. We've been working on this for a long time. And this is a website, decisiontrail.byu.edu, that is freely available to you and, well, to the public at large, I suppose. You go to this site, and you'll walk through a series of 4 questions that will help you analyze. If you ask these questions in this order for any project you're working on, you're always going to get to the right answer. So it's a pretty simple flow chart, and there's a video here that explains how it works.
Help you understand how the decision trail works, let's walk through a test case together. Say you were working on a project and you want to use an image that you found online. The project could be anything, like an article, a presentation, or a video. Our decision trail will guide you through a series of questions that will help you decide whether you can use the image without violating copyright law. The first question asks if the work is in the public domain. Under current law, images like photographs and drawings are automatically protected by copyright from the moment they are created. But the image in the test case might be in the public domain, if, for example, it's really old, or if it was created by the U.S. government. In that case, you can answer yes and skip to the end of the decision trail, meaning you can use the image however you want. Otherwise, you should answer no and proceed to the next question. The second question asks whether you have permission from the copyright holder to use the work. You might have permission, for example, if the copyright holder shared the work under a Creative Commons license or on a website with broad terms of use. In that case, you can answer yes and jump to the end of the decision trail, meaning you can use the image in accordance with the copyright holder's terms. Otherwise, you should answer no and move on to the next question. The third question asks if there is an exemption in copyright law other than fair use that covers your intended use of the work. You should answer yes if your use is covered by an exemption like the classroom exemption or library exemption. Otherwise, you should answer no and proceed to the last question. The fourth and final question asks if your intended use of the work qualifies as fair use. This question requires you to consider and balance the four fair use factors in connection with your intended use. We recommend using a tool like the Fair Use Evaluation Log, or FUEL, at fairusechecklist.byu.edu to help you make this determination. After considering all the factors, if you decide fair use applies to your case, you should answer yes. Otherwise, you should answer no, which means we recommend contacting the copyright holder to seek permission for your use. The BYU Copyright Licensing Office can help you secure licenses for your BYU-related projects. Just go to clearance.byu.edu and select which type of project you are working on to get started. If at any point during the decision trail you feel you need more information to answer one of the questions, just click on the question mark icon to get additional details.
Time, and it'll walk you through a specific use case that you may have. We also have, hopefully all of you got one of these on your chair, this handy user manual, which is meant to be kind of a hard copy reference to support the decision trail. So just quickly, if everybody can open up inside, you'll see what we have inside the manual here. There's an introduction page. On pages 4 and 5, you'll see an overview of the decision trail. One thing I want to point out here is there were four questions that were referenced. The third question about exemptions, we've had that kind of grayed out in this version of the book because for content creators and communicators, that's generally not applicable. It's more applicable to faculty members or folks who are working on the academic side of the university. So if you if you're doing social media or websites or those kinds of things, that question is generally not applicable to you. So in the pages that follow, we have examples for text, for images, for music, and sound recordings. And on each of these pages, we've skipped that question because it's generally not relevant to this group of people. We have examples of what yes and no looks like to each of those questions. And then on the right-hand side of each of those pages, we have specific scenarios with an analysis of how you would navigate the decision trail for that particular scenario that we have outlined. So these are obviously just a few examples to highlight. We can't possibly go through every single variation of copyright questions that people might have. And the point of this tool and this workshop is to teach this group of people some principles that they can use to apply to variations that are going to come up in your day-to-day work. And we're going to step through some examples. Oh, sorry, I forgot FUEL. How could I forget FUEL? So this is the tool that we developed in collaboration with the law school. A law professor, Clark Acey, did a comprehensive analysis of over 400 cases that have been decided by courts on fair use and went through each of those cases and carefully analyzed a number of factors about those cases. We plugged all of that data into a machine learning algorithm, and so now you can come along and answer the same questions that the court would ask, and as long as you answer honestly. Don't lie to FUEL, that's kind of defeats the purpose. If you answer these yes or no questions honestly, at the end of the analysis, you're going to get a gauge that predicts how a court would rule in your case based on the empirical data that we collected in collaboration with the law school. So we're really, really excited about this tool. It can give you a pretty high degree of confidence about how your fair use decision how fair use might apply in your particular case.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fairusechecklist.byu.edu.
Thank you.
Yep. So like Peter mentioned, we're going to go through a couple of examples now to just help you understand how to apply both the Decision Trail booklet that you have, as well as utilizing the fair use analysis log that we've just, or the fair use evaluation log that we've just looked at. So the first example here actually comes to us from the Accessibility Office here on campus. The Accessibility Office wanted to create an Instagram campaign highlighting celebrities who've dealt with different disabilities in order to help students understand that you can have hope and success even dealing with disabilities. And so they had reached out and asked if they were able to use this photo of Michael Jordan in their campaign. And so that's the question we're asking, and that's the question we're going to use the Decision Tool book that you have on your chair to answer. So if you'll open up to your images page, it's the yellow page in your book, page 8. And the first question that we're going to ask is when we say, can we use this image? A lot of people will ask us that question, and we always ask them, well, what do you mean by use? So the first thing that we always think about is what rights of the copyright holder are you going to implicate by your use of the image? So if we look here, which two rights, the use of the Michael Jordan photo that we just looked at, which two rights do you think that are implicated by the use that's anticipated here, using it on Instagram? We have a brave soul that's willing to, yes. Yes, that is one of them. The reproduction of the copyrighted work. Perfect. Another one. Yes. So that one is tricky. So distribution in the legal sense is generally you're transferring ownership. So in this case, distribution would not be correct, but thank you. That was a good guess. Yes.
Displaying the copyrighted work publicly.
Yes, perfect. Yep. Yep. So as you're thinking, can I use this image? This is helpful to kind of think through, what do you mean by use? And in this case, it's we're reproducing the image and we're publicly displaying it. So if we look here now in our Decision Trail booklet, we're going to ask ourselves the first question, which is this photo in the public domain? So the public domain, if you remember, is things that are really old. So if they were published more than 96 years ago, or if they were created by a federal government employee within the scope of their employment, or if the author has just released something into the public domain. So in this case, the image is not in the public domain. So we move on to the next question, which is, do you have permission to use the image? And this particular image we found through a Creative Commons license. So if you notice on the far left-hand side of the image, right over here, you can see an attribution going down the side. And it was licensed under a Creative Commons image, which that license requires you to provide an attribution. So we've done that here. So as long as you provide that attribution, you are okay to use this image. And we've actually created a little video to help you know how you can navigate using Google Images to find images that you can use in projects. So we're just going to look at that here.
Today we want to show you a little known but invaluable tool if you're looking for royalty-free images for use in a creative project. And it's all built right into Google. Say I'm looking for a great picture of a shark for a new brochure I'm working on called What's a Card Shark? Sharks Can't Play Cards and Other Fun Facts About Sharks. Working title. All I have to do is go to Google, search shark, then hit the Images tab. Over here, there's a little button called Tools. Click on that, and from the new filtering menu, select Usage Rights. Select the usage rights you need for your project. My brochure needs me to modify this photo slightly, so I'll choose the rights labeled Reuse with Modification. Then Google will sort the photos for you. It's always wise to go to the site that hosts the photo to double check that you can use it the way you want, but this search tool will help you find photos that have been specifically designated for reuse in creative projects. So there you go. It's just a quick tool built into Google, and it should save you a ton of time.
So hopefully that helps. We get that question a lot of how to use Google Images to find those resources. And so hopefully this helps. It's available on our YouTube channel. So if you go to the BYU Copyright Licensing YouTube channel, you'll find this video there. So we say, okay, great. The image is licensed under Creative Commons. We've provided our attribution. We're good to go. However, something to keep in mind today as we're talking through all of these examples is we are talking about using stuff and clearing it under copyright. There might be other areas of law that are applicable to the works that you're using that you need to consider that may limit your use of certain works. And so in this case, it's an image of Michael Jordan. There's obviously this right of publicity, which is a separate area of intellectual property that basically governs the use of people's images in relation with commercial promotion. And so people have the right to control their use of their image, their likeness, their name in connection with commercial exploitation. And so that's something to keep in mind as you are looking at using works. We have a little help. Hopefully this is helpful for you. If you think of this as your advertisement, we're using Peter here as our spokesperson saying, I think puppies are great, right? And we're promoting this puppy store. In this case, you know, Peter is okay with it. He's fine if you use his image in connection with this product. So you're okay under a rights of publicity analysis. However, if we get to, you know, I think hemorrhoid cream is great, Peter is less enthused about being associated with this product. And so, you know, he's probably not going to be okay with your use of that image in that case. And finally, if you put Peter's name next to this phrase, he is very upset. Peter is not a U of U football fan. And so in this case, he would be very unhappy and not okay with you using his image in connection with that that advertisement. So as you're thinking through using different works and using people's images, think through things that might be outside of the realm of copyright, but will also potentially limit have requirements for use.
Yeah, so the copyrights you need to get from the photographer, basically, and then you need to think about the subjects of the photos for this right of publicity issue. Okay, next example comes from the Texas A&M case. We're kind of giving away the end a little bit here, but this is straight from the headlines. Okay, so Michael Bynum is an author who wrote this book about the famous 12th man at Texas A&M University. He sent a manuscript of the book before he published it to the athletic department at Texas A&M. He wants them to give him some historical photos that he can include in the book. He'd like maybe a nice preface or foreword in the book by the athletic director at Texas A&M. And somebody in the athletic department sees this manuscript floating around and says, you know what would be great? Let's put this on the website. You know, lots of people that come to Texas A&M Athletics website would love to see a copy of this book. Do they need to get permission from the author to put the manuscript on the website? Okay, I see lots of heads nodding. That is, well, as you'll see in just a second, that is correct. Just to reiterate, the same two exclusive rights are implicated here. The first case was posting on Instagram. This one's posting on a website. But again, you're reproducing the manuscript. You're publicly displaying it on a website. So if you turn to page 6, hopefully if you were in the BYU athletic department and you saw a manuscript floating around like this, you would pull out this book. You'd say, this looks like text, and I think I have a book that helps me understand whether I can do that. Question 1, is it in the public domain? No. Question 2, do you have permission to use it? Oh, sorry. Do you have permission to use it? No. Question 3, is it fair use? You would go through the fair use evaluation log. You would come back realizing no, using 100% of this manuscript, even for 3 days. It was up on the weekend, just so you know, in this case, the manuscript was up for 1 weekend. And then it came down after Bynum complained, and now he's suing for lots of money. And it turns out the Texas A&M, as a public university, was able to get itself dismissed from the case. But you'll be pleased to know that the specific person who actually hit the upload button, that athletic director, associate athletic director, is still a defendant in the case. So you don't want to be that person, I'm going to guess. And so ultimately, what if you follow this flow chart, you would arrive down here at the obtained permission, which again just means that you need to go to Michael Bynum and say, hey, can we have your permission to post the manuscript or a portion of it on our website, and just work with him on that.
Okay, so our next example here comes to us from Divine Comedy. They want to create a funny parody video based on the Smash Mouth song All Star. They're going to change the lyrics to poke fun at Provo culture and Provo lifestyle, and they want to know if they need permission to be able to create this video. So we're going to show you just a clip of the actual Smash Mouth music video and then the parody, the Divine Comedy version.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead. Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming. I was feeling kind of dumb when the Y said I can't come.
they'll start coming and they don't stop coming. I hear 100K and I hit the ground running. Picking up chicks on Tinder is fun when the pics look great but the brains are dumb. Swipe right on girl's feet, I swap pink. I think I'll lead her off in 6 weeks. You'll never live till you're Nick Mo. Girls love a good summer sales, bro. Hey now, Trouble Wall Song.
Gives you an idea of the videos. And again, when we think about, okay, which rights are being implicated here, this one's slightly different. We are both reproducing, and then we are, this is adaptation. This is, you're creating derivative work. So we have the original Smash Mouth song, and you're just adapting that song. We're using the melody of the song and changing the lyrics. So that's creating an adaptation, and then we have the public performance. So by publishing this on YouTube, that's a public performance of the video. So those, as you're thinking through, what does my use look like? Think through these six exclusive rights. So if you open up now to your music page, we're gonna ask the same questions that we've been asking. One, is the song in the public domain? And hopefully by now, you can all kind of figure out, no, it's not in the public domain. This is a fairly recent song. So we get to, do we have permission? The song is not proactively licensed. We don't have it under any sort of database here at the university, so we do not have permission to use it. The next question we get to is this use fair use? So if you go over to Fuel, you can look through and it will ask you a series of questions to help you determine whether or not your use is fair. Now, one of the questions that you're going to be asked is, does your use qualify as parody as distinguished from a satire? So by raise of hands, how many of you in this room would consider the Divine Comedy video a parody? Okay, so, under the legal definition of parody, the video that we've looked at is actually not a parody. So under in legal definition, a parody is something that you use the original work in order to comment on the original work. So in this case, if we were using the song All Star to comment on the actual song of All Star, that would be legally a parody. What we have here is legally a satire, which is using the All Star song to comment on just comment on something that is not the actual work. So we're using the song to make a comment on Provo lifestyle and to poke fun at Provo culture. But we're not actually commenting on the All-Star song. So this video would be considered a parody as a satire as opposed to a parody. And when you look at fair use, parody is much more favored under fair use than is satire. And so satires can generally be, they can stand on their own feet. We didn't need to use the All-Star song in order to make our point with the Provo All-Star video. We could have used any other song and just changed the lyrics. But if it was a true parody, we would have to use that song because we're commenting on the song. So hopefully that makes sense for everybody. So in this case, we would say, go through the analysis, and we would come out saying, this is not a fair use. And so in this case, we would say, okay, let's go back to the decision trail, and we get to that last question, which is obtain licensing.
All right. I know it seems like we're obsessed with football. We really are not, but athletics is one of our most prominent public-facing entities, so our next example is a football one also. Athletics came to us recently, and they said they wanted to play some music videos on the Jumbotron over at LaVell Edwards Stadium during breaks at BYU football games. So, again, same question. We're wondering, do we need to go get permission to play music videos on the Jumbotron, and here's what that might look like. So just dance, dance, dance. So just dance, dance, dance. So just dance, dance, dance. So keep dancing. Enough as it was. We didn't need Justin Timberlake, and you're right. The football team did great. But if we're going to analyze this, again, there are three different copyrighted works actually in that one video that we need to look at separately. So the first one is the music composition. That's the song and the lyrics. The next one is the sound recording. Justin Timberlake actually, that recording of the song. And then the video piece. So all three of those are different, and we have to look at them separately. Then we also, again, have to think about which are the exclusive rights are implicated by this. Now, hopefully this is becoming a little familiar by now. Does anybody think they know we're at LaVell Edwards Stadium? There are 60,000 people there. Does one of these rights stick out as, who wants to take a guess as to what at least one of the two exclusive rights that are implicated? Number, Number five. Well, this one, actually, because it's a video, it's a performance. If it were a still photo in front of 60,000 people, that would be a public display. But since it's a video, it's a performance of the video. So number four. And then I think we're probably not going to stream this just straight from YouTube onto the Jumbotron at LaBelle Upper Stadium. We'll probably have a local copy that we're making of the video there. And so I'm assuming there's going to be a reproduction for this use. So those are the two rights. And so in analyzing this, we need to walk through the decision trail a total of six times. Okay, I'm just trying to help everybody understand that when our office looks at these, this is a live question that actually came to us, and this is exactly how we thought about it. We went through for the music composition, the sound recording, the video, and then each of the rights separately. Okay, so if we look at the reproduction piece, again, this is the local copy that you need there at LaBelle Upper Stadium to do this. And by this point, we're familiar. No, that's not in the public domain. We get all the way down to the fair use analysis, and this is literally when we ran it through Fuel. Look at that. But it leans in favor of fair use. The reason it does is because, to the best of our knowledge, there's not a place you can go to buy music videos. If there were a DVD store or something where we could get a DVD of the Justin Timberlake video, we would go and buy it, and we wouldn't have to worry about this issue. But because there is no market, to our knowledge, for purchasing and owning music videos, we don't think we're disrupting a market, and so the fair use just barely comes out in our favor, so we feel comfortable with the reproduction. So for those, we feel like you would end up down here, or you'd be permitted for use, and we can fill in that row. The same analysis would hold for all three of these works, so we just fill in that whole row. Okay, now if we turn to the public performance piece. Again, Can't Stop the Feeling is not in the public domain. It's not something we have permission for. We do have permission. The reason is because BYU pays a big annual license to ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC. It's a blanket license that we pay for all the public performance of music on this campus. So congratulations, BYU. The Dionne Concert Hall, football games, when you're in the Cougar Eat downstairs and you hear the music over, all that music has all been paid for. The public performance of it has been paid for by the university. So, and it applies, to the music performed at football games. Okay, so now we're on to the sound recording. As it turns out, if you remember from the beginning, there's no public performance right in sound recordings except for digital audio transmissions. We're not trying to run Pandora or Spotify with this, so we actually don't even have to worry about the sound recording. That's not applicable. All right, now the video. We're going to be performing this video on the Jumbotron in front of 60,000 people at LaBelle Upper Stadium. We know that it's not in the public domain. We don't have permission for it. Is it fair use? We did this. That's where the needle came out. That's a no. Which means that we think we would need to go and get permission. So that's exactly what we recommended to athletics, is that they go and seek permission. And sadly, when they did that, the price came back a little higher. I mean, athletics has a nice budget, but it was more than they wanted to pay. So sorry, Cougar fans. Let's go win some bowl games and get more money into athletics so we can all enjoy Justin Timberlake at the next season's football games. Yeah. Yeah. It's just the composition. That's all it is. But the sound recordings, when you're playing recorded music publicly on our campus, you don't have to worry about it because there's no public performance right in sound recordings. Yeah.
So obviously you're playing the video now. Oh. Which means that there's some sort of educational component to it, right?
Yeah.
So if we are using these images or videos for an educational purpose on our website, is that okay?
Yeah. So when we went through the Fuel and Out, we went through this exact, that's a really good question. In deciding whether or not we could show the clips of the videos that we've shown, we went through Fuel, and we concluded, well, actually there's an exemption. Remember that third question that we grayed out because it doesn't apply to social media posts and other things. In a classroom setting, which this is, we're in training setting for nonprofit educational training purposes, there are specific exemptions that apply there.
And let me just make one clarification. The face-to-face teaching exemption is different than if you want to post things online. So that is a distinction that we need to make. If you're posting something on Learning Suite or to a website or whatever, that is different than what we're doing here today.
Yeah, so that's important. So one final takeaway from all this is we kind of saved this one till the end so you get a sense of, it can get a little tricky and complicated, but if you just peel back and look at each layer individually, you know, the analysis you're going through will get you to the right answer. And in a case like this where 5 out of these 6 boxes are green, basically, but this pesky little 6th box down here requires permission, the whole project requires permission. So that's another kind of key takeaway. It's not just enough to say, oh, my use of that image was okay, but the music behind it wasn't, so I'm just gonna go ahead and post the video to YouTube or whatever. You gotta look at them all separately. Okay, with that, we're gonna turn the time over to Heidi and Michael Handley to talk through some specific, oh, yes, yes. Oh, yeah, that's a great question. Sure. I mean, yeah, obviously, if you want to make your own music video not like the Provo All-Star example where you're altering it and doing your own recording of it, you know, because that adaptation would require a separate, if we were doing an adaptation, we would need another row on this chart. But yeah.
Like a dance cam or something.
Yeah, if you're just, yeah. In fact, that happens frequently on the Jumbotron. Again, I'm assuming all of you were at the game on Saturday, so you know that you know, there's always music playing and the camera's panning around the audience and we're all dancing and that's a video of people dancing and we're fine to do that. Okay, hey, we're gonna take a few more questions at the end because I want to be sure Heidi and Michael have time, but we'll have time at the end for questions. Thanks, everybody.
Yes, we need time because we're the best part, right, Michael? I want to welcome our special guest, Michael Handley, here. I'm Heidi Tuning. I'm a licensing director at the Copyright Licensing Office here at BYU. And Michael and I have become good friends over the last few months as we've been working on China Spectacular, which I hope many of you are familiar with. You got a little preview, a little bit of what Sister Worthen talked about a couple weeks ago in devotional. And Michael's here as the producer of China Spectacular to share with us some of the copyright issues that we encountered. So Michael, why don't you tell this group a little bit about China Spectacular.
You said we became friends over the last 2 months. It's been the last 2 years. It's been a long, long, lengthy battle here. President Worthen 2 years ago asked us to produce a show to take to China to re-solidify our friendship with the people of China, to open doors and make connections just reintroduce the university over there. He asked for a show similar to Homecoming Spectacular, which is a bit of a complicated show to put together alone, but now he's asking us to take that show on tour and to China, of all places. So we took components of 8 of our performing groups, and that's about 170 students performing, and then a staff of about 30 to 35 full-time employees and student employees and just regular students. Not all were employed. And we went to China for 2.5 to 3 weeks, toured 3 cities, Beijing, Xi'an, and Shanghai. And we were in very prominent theaters. It was a great tour. But we had a lot of copyright issues that had to be worked out prior to getting there. Everything from securing arranging rights for the songs to be produced, and then we had promotional videos we were creating, which you'll see some samples of. And then we needed performance rights to do the shows, to do the shows in China. There's a whole layer upon layer upon layer of this, and I did not go through this diagram chart. I didn't have the diagram chart when I started this 2 years ago, and even if I did, I probably would have gone to Heidi anyway, because this was a show that I could not have any errors on. We've had our ensembles on tour that have been stopped at the theater not able to perform because they did not have the proper clearances at the theater in the foreign country. Something as high profile as this for the university and for the church, we couldn't afford any kind of slips or mistakes. So we engaged Heidi from the very beginning and had her scrutinize every piece, every graphic, every piece of music, everything we did. We tried to have her go through and approve and then make the connections over in China for permission to perform in China. So with that introduction, she'll take you through.
Yeah, so this has been a really fun project. Lots that we've learned and discovered, but our intent here is to show you how you could use the Decision Trail and how this production used a lot of resources available to us here at BYU and our office as well to help them navigate these issues. So our first example, Michael, this is Moliwa. So tell us just a little bit about this song and its importance in the production.
Moliwa was an encore number. It wasn't put into the program, but very early in our discussions, we wanted to have an encore number that we could perform. We wanted to do something that the Chinese people knew that was beloved. And Moliwa is a traditional folk song that dates back about 300 to 400 years. It also is a song that our ensembles, Young Ambassadors, have performed there previously. And the folk dancers had costuming and choreography to go to this that went with this song to begin with. So it was an easy song for us to consider as an encore option.
So what you'll see here is the actual performance. BYU TV was actually there in China filming for an upcoming production of China Spectacular that you'll be able to see on BYU TV. And they were kind enough to share this footage with us. So let's have a look at this performance. Performing that music in a theater. What's happening in that scenario? Which of these rites? Hopefully this is starting to sound familiar to you. Just like the stadium, a video being performed in the stadium, this music being performed in a theater would have been a public performance of that music. So that's the rite that we want to be thinking about when we ask, can I use this music in this production? So if we ask ourselves the first question on our list, is this in the public domain? I see some of you sort of looking at that. Michael talked about how this is a really old work, 18th century. So our answer actually here is yes, which means that we can exit the Decision Trail and the song is permitted for use. So while we did reach out and we were getting the licenses in China to be able to perform this, the music that was being performed, we didn't have to worry about Moliwa because it's in the public domain. So let's go on to our next example. 40 Years of Friendship video. Oh, can we just hold the questions till the end? Thank you. Yeah, so Michael, why don't you tell us about the 40 Years of Friendship video?
There were two components, two things we needed to accomplish with our production. One was entertain the people of China. The second was to share with them some of the things that we feel strongly about educationally. And to stop and talk during the show kind of slows down the performance. So we produced a video that ran prior to the show starting, which shares with the people of China some of the programs that we have going, or some of the athletic programs, the China flagship program, the teachers, Chinese teachers program, many of the things that the university does as an outreach to the world. And so we did this in the context of this pre-show videotape.
So let's see a clip.
杨白汉大学并不是一所只有表演艺术的学校，我们是一所有超过三万全职学生的世界级的大学。我们的商业系、教育系和护理科以及法学院是全美国排行前二十名。
Timberlake video, there's a lot of stuff going on even in just this one video. We're going to take it piece by piece. We'll take this one photograph, this one image as representative of the others. You saw others. And we'll just take this one when we think about the rights that are being implicated, just think back to the Michael Jordan example. This is a picture that's being put into this video. This is a public display and also a reproduction. Those are the rights that are happening with the use of this image. As we go to our decision trail, we ask, is it in the public domain? This is a recent picture. We've got our photographer right there. He's not dead. He's still around. This is not in the public domain. Still has copyright protection. So the next question, do you have permission to use it? In this instance, this is a BYU photo. And for those of you who may not know, BYU photos are available for campus use. And this, a lot of the photos that you just saw in there, most of those, all those photos were from BYU Images. So this is a great resource that we have here at the campus. And because this is a BYU photo, we were able to use it and exit the decision trail. So that was a nice use of BYU materials in this video. Next, think about the music that you heard. So there were images, there was also music going on and accompanying sound recording. So thinking about just the music, again, this is starting to sound familiar. I hope that's by design. We think that, well, we know that you are content communicators and creators. What you're going to be dealing with often when you're posting on social media or on the website, and whether you're using music or images, you're going to be dealing with some of these same rights. Public display in the case of an image, public performance in the case of music. And so we wanted to give examples to you that would be most helpful to you. So some of these rights are going to sound the same, and they are. This is, again, a public performance and a reproduction. So the first question, is it in the public domain? No, this is actually a track from Omni Music. It's a recent composition. It's called Endless Air. It's not in the public domain. It's protected by copyright. Second question, do you have permission to use it? Well, if you look at your yes examples, some examples of music that's permitted to use are collections here at the university, and Omni Music is one of these music collections that the university has invested in a license to make music available to the campus community to use in their creative projects. So this was another excellent use of some material available here at BYU to create this video. So you can exit the decision trail with the music. So then, just a reminder, you've also got a sound recording. You've got the underlying composition, the notes of the music, but you also have the actual sound recording. Justin Timberlake singing the song, or in this case, the sound recording, the performance of the music. So just the analysis comes out the same way, the outcome comes out the same way in this instance. You do have permission to use it. This is Omni Music. It's the composition and the sound recording that you're allowed to use, so you can exit the decision trail and your project is good to go. So our last example for you today is the BYU Dunk Team video. Michael, tell us about this one. This is a fun one.
We produced 6 videos that we wanted to use as promotional material. The idea was to release a month to 2 months prior to our arriving in China. We wanted to release to the Chinese social media platforms with the intent of these videos going viral. We wanted them to be very upbeat, very exciting, very interesting, very engaging. So we used one video was featured the Young Ambassadors, one the folk dancers, one Cougarettes. So 6 altogether. And the one you're going to see here is the Dunk Team, which is one of the more unusual groups that we took to China and one of the more popular and fun. And I think you'll enjoy this video clip.
Again, this is getting repetitive. I hope you're starting to understand what's happening in that video when you're using music, and we'll also talk briefly about the sound recording, but you're using music and you're publicly performing it and you're reproducing it. Those are the rights that are implicated by using music in a video. So, first question, is it in the public domain? This music is not in the public domain. It was written by Michael Nielsen and Kava Cohen, and it's protected by copyright. Do you have permission to use it? No, unfortunately, it wasn't something that was already licensed to us or that we had permission from the publishers to use. Does it qualify as fair use? So when you go through the analysis, no, unfortunately it doesn't. This is a promotional video. You're using the entire song, the whole sound recording, all of the music. There is a very robust licensing market for licensing music to use in videos like this. So doing it without getting a license would be impacting the market for that work, which all of that unfortunately leans against fair use. So no, this is not a fair use of music. And finally, that means that you would need to obtain permission for your use of the music in the video, which we did. We were able to reach out to the publisher and get permission for our use of the music in the video. Again, similarly, just don't forget, when you have a song, you also have a sound recording. Now, if the dunk team were singing that song or something, if it was a BYU recording, you wouldn't have to worry about the sound recording because it would be BYU-owned, but it was a popular recording by Ninja Trax of the underlying composition. So again, the outcome is the same. Not fair use, not public domain, didn't have permission. So needed to obtain permission. We were able to get that from the record label. So those are the few examples that we had for you today. I wanted to ask if anybody had some questions for Michael about China Spectacular while we have him here. Yeah, go ahead, Rebecca.
So here in the US, our copyright for Creative Commons is, or for going into the personal public domain, is 96 years. I'm assuming that changes when you go to other countries.
Yes, it does. And in China, it's life of the author plus 50 years. Happily, this is such an old work that it's before even copyright was established for China. Any questions specifically for Michael?
Well, mine goes along with that. Like, how are copyright laws different, specifically in China, compared to the United States? And what challenges do you face?
So, happily, with this particular production, the main licensing that we were getting were public performance licenses. So, as Peter mentioned, here in the United States, BYU pays performance rights organizations, ASCAP, CSEC, BMI, for performances that we have here on campus. In China, they have a counterpart, the MCSC, if I'm remembering the acronym, and we were able to actually get local counsel, by that I mean attorneys in China, to help us navigate that. So I acted as our liaison here with Michael, getting them all the information that they needed, but getting the public performance rights for those performances was pretty simple. And then helping Michael here with some of the media that they wanted to share was something that we could handle here. But certainly, yeah, different countries have their own laws that we need to be aware of.
Of all the trouble we had in China with this production, we had no problem with copyright.
Yes. Yes. Any other questions for Michael?
We knew that we were intending to release for North America, I believe. We licensed for North America and for China.
Mm-hmm.
So at the time that we did the licensing, we knew we would release here and also in China. I believe you have to target whatever territory you intend to play in. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. So when we were asking publishers to use music here from the United States in China to be able to establish it, we just asked for a worldwide license, meaning we could perform it anywhere. And we ran into a couple issues with some social media platforms. They're different in China, and so we ran into a few wrinkles there trying to navigate what was permitted to be shared more than on just BYU-branded social media, but in China on their social media. But we were able to get the permissions that we needed.
And I believe that is all term limited, is that?
Yes. To keep the fees down, I think we did a year, or 18 months, we did 18 months. So that's something that you should be thinking about as you embark on licensing projects. You can use popular music, it's going to cost, and you'll just have to have a budget in place for that, and that's why you just have to weigh how important is that popular music to your project. In this case, it was pretty important for that Dunk Team video to have that music associated with it.
Detailed is that permission to use? This isn't just a phone call and they say, sure, no problem. Is it when we reach out for permission to use, is it a written document?
Yes, it is. It's a, we're submitting a document with a bunch of details of our request, and we're telling them exactly how we want to use it, where we want to distribute it, on what platforms. We're telling them what it's about and what it's for, how long we want it. And it can take, it does, Michael says we've been working on this for years. The licensing part has been for several months, and it does take time. Sorry, I know we're very short on time. For those of you who need to leave, please feel free. We'll still continue answering a few questions here. Just a note that if you want to take more copies of our decision trail back to your teams, please do. You can grab copies in the back. And cupcakes. Our copyright cupcakes, the little C on the top, is actually edible, so enjoy. Thank you, everybody.
Finish your question. They also have stipulations back to us that how we need to credit the work. So in our program, we have to list whoever the creators were or whatever.
The conditional agreement, if you do, we give you permission if you do this and this and this.
So we're happy to talk with anybody who has questions offline. Thank you so much for coming, everyone. Michael, thank you so much. We have some fudge for you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Michael.
Michael, thanks for coming.
My pleasure. Got me out of the office.
There you go, yeah. We'll change the scene.